pleasure to receive Maxime Kontsevich, who is going to talk about the geometry in triangulated categories.
Okay, thank you. What I will talk about, suppose we have a scheme. So in my talk, I'll pick some field based field K. It must be some density, but it can be parallelized. Suppose I have a scheme X over this field K. Then I can associate the category which is denoted by Cx, which would be quasi coherent X. What does it mean? It's unbounded derived category of quasi coherent sheaves. So it means that we can consider complexes of sheaves, quasi-coherent sheaves, which are locally modules without any finiteness conditions, and complexes can go from minus infinity to plus infinity. So it's a big category. In fact, I will tacitly assume it, it's kind of enhanced, so it's enriched to, for example, enriched to complexes. So Holmes are not just abelian groups, but a zero cohomology of some complexes, which calculate these groups. And this category has two properties. So this category is a triangulated category closed under arbitrary small homotopy limits. In triangulated categories, it's essentially reduced to has kind of infinite sums. And second, this category has a tensor product, a symmetric monoidal tensor product over X, which also preserves collimits, or commute with infinite sums. And this is kind of gives an adequate description of my scheme. For example, if you go in a set of schemes, you do whatever derived highest x, also can associate such categories. It's, you don't lose any information. And yeah, so it's adequate description. And what is non-commutative free point? On this thing, just forget tensor product. So we kind of cross out the structure. We just have category with collimits, and one can give the first definition, a kind of a non-commutative space. NC space, in short, X is something called by a category, which is K linear triangulated category, enriched over complexes. DG category, say. So Holmes are complexes. And for such enrichment, it is known this proper, it is triangulated. It's not some additional data like triangles. It's actually property being triangulated. And has arbitrary infinite sums. That's it. What has collimit, and we want to study such object as kind of geometric object. There are much less expressive power. We don't have tensor product, so it's very little one can say about this generality. But you'll see that it's in fact one can say really a lot. And the plan will be the following. First, I'll start with some examples. Then I'll go to some kind of way to think about this triangulated categories, borrowing notions from commutative world. So I will describe kind of really non-commutative phenomena, which can be complicated from usual viewpoint. And third, I will briefly mention some perspective from Poincaré categories and mirror symmetry. So that's the plan, but now this desk has to disappear for a while. Start with examples. And for me, there are going to be three sources of examples. First is algebraic geometry, which I already mentioned. If you get a scheme or stack over the field K, then you get this category CX, which is a very big category. Another example is algebra. And if you have A, which is differential graded algebra over K, then one can construct the space which will denote by kind of non-commutative spectrum of A, which is not a set, it's just it's kind of completely formal notation. These two effects will be A modules in the appropriate sense. For example, one consider A modules, but or consider all A modules, differential graded A modules, but A infinity morphisms. Some technical tool to make calculate right X groups, or you can see the modules which are kind of generated by some set of generators kind of filtered by sequence generators, net generators, and so on. In differential, it's free as A module is not differential, and differential is kind of upper triangular. Yeah, so it's there are various versions, and in fact, it's kind of
no finite distribution.
Sir?
No finite.
No finite. It's nothing, yeah. And in sense, kind of collimit, natural collimit completion of the DG category is one object. When you get endomorphism is equal to category is one object. Let's say E. And endomorphism of E will be A opposite. So consider A is one dimensional, is the A module, and all the rest is formally obtained by taking infinite sums and cones and so on. Yeah, so that's maybe just no, it's nothing. It's something. I have just this is C of X. This is a category. It's just completely formal notation. Means nothing. No sets. Nothing.
X is A.
No, not A. Yeah, it's kind of opposite. Yeah. Oh, kind of opposite of A. Yeah. And so source is topology. Namely, suppose I have X, the origin of the space will be some curly X, some topological space, and stratification. You can think about like cell complex and finite stratification or some manifold stratification. And what is the category CX? Is again unbounded direct category of consider sheaves on X. On X, which are constructible for stratification sigma. It means that on each stratum, the cohomology shifts will be locally constant. Yeah, so there are three different examples, but in fact, there are a lot of common points. Let me just show this a very simple, just very simple common example. In algebraic geometry, we consider let's say or GM or a punctured affine line raised to some power n. It's algebraic torus. In algebra, what we consider the algebra in non-commutative respect, in my sense, of algebra of Laurent polynomials in n variables. These are just coordinates. Yeah, this is tautology, kind of algebraic geometry. Quasi-coherent shifts are the same as modules of algebra functions, this algebra functions. But this ring is actually a group ring of the fundamental group of a torus. So in topology, the space is a torus, and trivial stratification. So we consider kind of local system on a torus. That's it. One. Since trivial example of how things coincide in different worlds. But the second example, it's less trivial. Now, if X is a projective line, it again has two competing descriptions. In terms of algebra, you can see the algebra will be past algebra of what's called Kronecker quiver. It has two vertices and two arrows. The representation is just two vector spaces, two complexes, and two morphisms. It's Kronecker quiver. And how one thing is related, if you have, let's say, coherent shifts on P1, you want to associate two vector space, you put here home from of 1 to your and one vertex, and here put home of O0. Because there are two non-trivial maps from O0 to O1, you get two maps here, and it's completely get the same triangulated category. And what goes in topology? I'll just draw the picture. X is a circle with the following stratification: a point and an interval. And if you consider constructible shift, it has one fiber here, one fiber on the open part. But then you have two specialization maps. Because specialization maps, you get the same as Kronecker quiver. Yeah. Yeah, so it's you see, you can describe the same category in three different languages. And in fact, the same space can have different description even in one language. For example, if X is abelian variety, abelian variety of any dimension, then we have another space which is dual abelian variety, which is line bundles of rank zero of degree zero on A. It's kind of dual abelian variety. It's in general, it's a different variety. And but the categories of coherent shifts, quasi coherent shifts, are equivalent. It's called Fourier-Mukai transform. And how it goes on the product of two varieties? On you have universal line bundle. And then if you have a shift on X, you take has first take pullback of your shift to the product, multiply by line bundle, and take projection. And okay, observe that it's equivalence. Also in algebra you can have different algebras giving the same category. It's called Mariette equivalence, or direct Mariette equivalence. For the DJ. two algebras. Just the simplest case, if you have algebra A, any digit algebra, say, or algebra, degree zero, and we consider A prime, which should be matrix algebra of any size with coefficients in A. Then, category A modules include the category A prime modules. Yeah, so one can describe this think in a different way. And yeah, in principle one can produce, but there are more complicated examples of different space specification also given the same category. Okay. Now this is essentially all my basic examples to keep in mind. Now I'm going to explain how to define some notions for this non-commutative space, borrowing some ideas from commutative world. Yeah. So I gave you, say, what are spaces, but I didn't tell you what is a morphism. And definition is a morphism for two non-commutative spaces is the same as a pair of adjoint functors namely you get you get two categories and you get F upper star and F lower star and such that F lower star preserves polynomials, or they call the same as infinite sums. F upper star preserves polynomials automatically because it's left adjoint. But right adjoint is not necessary of such type. And if you see, if you know that. It's like geometric morphism of torpuses. It's really a very, it's kind of completely parallel definition. And what is nice, kind of, why it corresponds to reality, if X, Y are usual schemes, and you get usual morphism, but I need to put some technical condition, it should be quasi-compact. So consider open domain is a tree which will have finite covering. Then it gives you automatically such gap between categories. And in parenthesis, this second factor to have a preserving polynomials, it indicates it should have still another adjoint, which will be kind of F upper freak, which is wasn't really considered in algebraic geometry. But it's that's the notion of morphism. And that's it. That was in the 1985, the morphism. Now I define what is a vector bundle. On X is the same as a morphism from X to a point.
Yeah, which is looks a bit bizarre definition, but if you unwind it, you see that it's the same as a compact object in CX. So one dimensional vector space goes by pullback to some vector bundle. And compact object E, it means that home from E preserves collimates. So it's the only game is preserving these collimates. And in real life, it corresponds I'll call this object perf, set of such objects denoted by perf of X. As you can see, X is a full subcategory of such compact objects. For schemes of algebras, it's really perfect complexes as defined traditionally by Grothendieck. So locally finite complexes of finite dimensional vector bundles in the brief geometry. Subcategory closed under colimits in CX. So you get some big class of objects automatically. And object is called generator if you get all objects. And definition X is affine if there exists a compact generator. Now in this case we see that CX will be just equal to AB modules, and you see that X will be this non-commutative spectrum of one algebra. Okay, so you describe it in pretty concrete terms. Okay, so it looks like very special properties of for schemes. It's basic schemes through which we start to build general schemes, but amazing fact, which was proven many years ago by Bondal and Vandenberg. If X is quasi-compact, so it has some finite covering, let's say separated scheme, then X is affine in non-commutative sense. So there is a nice perfect complex of shifts which generate X. And what are examples? Just to get you feeling, for example, if X is projective space, then the generating object will be O of 0 plus O of 1 up to O of n. That's an endomorphism algebra will be just finite dimensional algebra in degree zero. Or if X, for example, is, I don't know, something like affine space minus zero, which is not affine space in usual space, against this, or X is already a good affine generator in the non-commutative space sense. So quasi affine schemes are affine in dramatically. So it's kind of completely changed perspective in this non-commutative geometry. So we don't worry about topos, gluing, and so on. So everything is so simple and affine. It's kind of a little bit of oversimplification, but it works. And for example, one can easily, for affine schemes, can describe what is a morphism between affine schemes is the same as a bimodal MF, which is A left module over A and right over B, which is perfect as A module. And the functor F lower star at upper star is given just by tensor product. It is this guy. And then we can draw also F lower star in a similar way. It's also tensor product. You can see the dual with respect to A action.
Okay.
Yeah, so far one can in algebraic geometry, we have some basic properties of morphisms, which good to have. In this non-commutative field, I don't know, but there are at least more morphisms from 2 points, in a sense, properties of non-commutative space itself. Maybe I'll say first affine non-commutative space. Description terms of one DG algebra. So the historically the first kind of very important property was property to be called saturated. Saturated in algebraic geometry correspond to smooth and proper variety. There was some kind of intrinsic meaning, maybe explained by Lurie. It means that this category, maybe category of perfect complexions of X, is dualizable object. Whatever it means. In the world of in triangulated category, maybe small triangulated category. Categories, but in fact, it was this notion was originally introduced by Bornell and Kapranov in the early 90s, and then later I tried to expect simultaneous kind of separately property to be smooth and proper. So, non-commutative properness means very simple that algebra is perfect as vector space or complex vector space. So, in plain words, it means that. Total cohomology are finite dimensional. So one can really reduce to finite dimensional maybe infinity algebra. And smoothness is also a pretty neat property. It means that algebra is perfect as a bimodule. And why is this two words? For schemes of, let's say, finite type, it's exactly correspond to usual properties. And with usual properties. Yeah. Also some further things is called finite type by Turner and Michel Becquier, but I will not talk about it. Yeah. Okay, so that's really most important class of spaces. And then one can speak about.
That's really big topic. Maybe I just
again exchange.
What about analog of the risky topology? So, a bit about open embeddings. Fully faithful factor. Or one can say it's in rephrase in many different words, this identity of CU to this adjunction morphism is equivalent. Or another word to say that it's considered compose the thing from opposite thing from CX to itself, you get a co-idempotent common ad. And it's all completely general, so it works for arbitrary this category, so this will be definition of opening and the open embedding. Is equivalent to any of these properties. And then what is a remarkable goes on here, in this case one gets automatically another full subcategory of something which is called closed embeddings. One can consider left orthogonal to CX. And what will be again in algebraic geometry? In algebraic geometry, it will be category of quasi-coherent shifts on X with support on Z, where Z is a closed subset, not subscheme, it's subset, which is complement to U. Yeah. So we have thematically this. This is another category. Ah, by the way, I forgot to say that in bundle Vandenberg theorem, even such categories also have compact generators when you fix support condition. And what happens? You get three non-commutative spaces, and you get. Two adjoint functors, and you get another two adjoint functors, and these are full embeddings. And one defines another. For example, you also get idempotent monad, and similar story. So it's completely a standard situation. Generated category is called Riemann. Or it will be a special class of semi-orthogonal decomposition for these big categories. Namely, of big categories. So any object, for any object in CX, one can uniquely represent it as a, make it an extension, make exact triangles or a first guide.
is you get Cx with support of x minus u, and here's from Cu.
So we can uniquely decompose concrete lenses. And yeah, that's very nice situation. And if x is affine, then such situation one can play with definition, and you see that it's described by completely elementary data. First of all, then u is again affine automatically. In the sense, you can restrict shift O to U to get the generator. So it will be this non-commutative spec for some algebra B. And what will also, you just get a restriction map. It gives you homomorphism of DG algebras or K-infinity algebras with a property such that if you consider derived product of B over A with B, you replace maybe by standard complex and it maps to B, is a quasi-isomorphism. Yeah, so it's kind of elementary equation in linear algebra which describes this categorical data, and it's called the non-commutative localization. Now, yeah, just simplest example you can try to see polynomials in one variable embed to polynomials in Poulard polynomials. That would be basic example. And in such situation, you have description of two categories, A modules, B modules. What will be the third category? What will be the category of Cx supported on x minus u? It will be just collection of all A modules that B can A with 0. Yeah, so you get some category which you describe in terms of linear algebra, but they are not affine spaces in general. There's no, a priori, there's no proper generator. And that's actually a very convenient class of categories. Essentially, all natural construction which you can imagine led to this class. They have it's some kind of like analog of scheme description by open covering. And for such categories, one can easily describe what are morphisms or whatever, again in terms of linear algebra. It will be similar. So this work is closed under itself, and it can be sort of replacement of affine schemes. For example, in Bondel-Vandenberg theorem, there are some conditions. The scheme is quasi-compact. If it's not quasi-compact, even not separated, the category of quasi-Cauchy shift will be again of this shape for some tricky non-commutative algebras, which I don't want to describe you. Warning. So it looks that we have some notion of open domains, but there is nothing like the risky topology. One can easily work out some examples. And see that these things cannot work in parallel to algebraic geometry. For example, we take elliptic curve. And elliptic curve, which is considered the same, elliptic curve, and then you describe a category using two languages, using one curve or using Fourier-Mackay transform another curve. Then you get some open domain, which is E minus U, and it gives open domain in non-commutative sense. Here you get kind of dual domain E minus U. Then you get these two subcategories, C1 and C2, in the whole category X.
and the intersection is zero, and they together generate X. Yeah, so it's kind of contradictory situation. It looks like two open spaces with open intersection and cover everything. But the category is not direct sum. Yeah, so it means that one cannot really use ideas of locality. In some situation, when this projectors was this kind of idempotence or co-idempotence commute, it behaves exactly like algebraic geometry. One can glue, make intersection, and but if they're not commute, one cannot imitate algebraic geometry. Mm. I think it's not really a disaster because it's a completely different language which is kind of algebraized, described in terms of linear algebra. Topos direction cannot go far. One can try to develop some kind of differential geometry, and the smooth algebras, smooth spaces are especially good. One can get tangent bundles and so on. In a very big generality, one can define something like one can see the vector fields or the polyvector fields. This is Hochschild homology. Yeah, I will describe it for affine X. But this more general story, when you get two algebras, it's also one can translate definition to this more general framework easily. So the Hochschild homology is defined as form category of bimodules of A to itself. And for usual manifolds in algebraic geometry, it's a direct sum of homology of X with polyvector fields. And this is something which is responsible for deformation of X as non-commutative space. If you have usual skin deformation given by H1 with coefficients in vector fields, you get this A and J to 1. But if, for example, here it's 0 and here it's 2, you get bivector fields, you get kind of Poisson structures, you get non-quantum deformations. Or if you put 2 and 0, you get jerks. Bundles of Hadzumai algebras. Yeah, so that's one story, and also we have kind of forms, differential forms, like one form. And this is called Hochschild homology. Which is a tensor product of A, tensor A S module over the opposite. And again, for skins, you get homology of X with omega j. But the funny thing here is omega, this will be placed in degree I minus j, not like in usual Hodge theory. You place degree in forms in negative direction. For example, if you consider total degree zero, get Hi of omega I, you get kind of like Hodge classes all sits in degree zero. And the Ram differential, it's called Kohn differential in non-commutative world. It's certain auxiliary operator here of degree minus one. And one can combine forms and differential and get something called periodic cyclic homology. Which is analog of the Ramp homology. And again, there is a kind of nice miracle here in the non-commutative world. If you take usual, let's say, affine scheme, or maybe not affine scheme, but with singularities, usual Dirac cohomology, it's kind of strange, nonsensical object. But here you get cohomology of, let's say, or complex numbers of underlying topological space to the crystalline cohomology. So this notion kind of resolves singularity. Now there is some pretty beautiful calculus relating these things, like you take all various operations between forms and polyvector fields, except cup products for forms. Yeah, there was some calculus story developed maybe 10 years ago. And maybe the last thing you should say about volume element. And again, it was something which was first discovered by Bondel and Kapranov. You can vary the generality, but it's simplest to say it's for saturated space, and it's smooth and compact. Smooth and proper. By the way, for this smooth and proper space, all this cohomology will be finite dimensional. In this case, it's easy to see that there is this cell functor, we call it cell functor, S from this capital to itself, which is upper equivalence, which is defined by the following property. You can see the two objects in a perfect, you can see the two perfect complexes. Homes will be finite dimensional. You take dual space, and then this functor will be again representable. And in algebraic geometry, this set functor is multiplication by canonical class and shift by dimension. If it's, let's say, smooth projective variety, again, just a product of this. Okay. Now, you see that in particular, we can speak about Calabi-Yau varieties. Calabi-Yau of dimension D, which is integer. It will be the things with surf functor is equivalent to shift functor by me.
Actually,
it's a really important point here about this canonical class. You see, if you get a smooth projective variety with of general type, when kx is ample, or Fano variety when it's minus kx is ample, by making a positive or negative iteration of S and making a conform identity functor, you can reconstruct a ring of functions in projective embedding, given by canonical bounds. So you can reconstruct a variety, just intrinsically from the category.
If X is general type, in this case, in algebraic geometry, it's positive or negative, it can be reconstructed from the category. But if canonical class is trivial up to shift, you cannot do it,
and it means that different Calabi-Yau varieties can have the same triangulated category. So this, to have canonical class is really very important here. Like you saw example with abelian varieties, which also have trivial canonical class.
So that's
important. Business here, and I just mentioned briefly, one can, if one's right to think it's analog of like smooth projective or proper varieties, one can try to maintain the idea of motifs in its various versions, like numerical motifs or Voivodsky motifs, and it, as a whole story, it works very well, and in fact definitions are much simpler than in Voivodsky theory, just really kind of one-line definition, what is category of motifs. You consider, let's say, these saturated spaces, but as a course, consider K-series spectrum of category of functors, of bimodules, and give the category enriched by spectrums, which, you get cones and get triangulated category of motifs. It all looks very nice in a much more natural effect, I think, than in usual commutative world.
Sorry, one question. The left-hand side was just formulated now for a fine X. Is there a generalization of these concepts now for general?
For such ways.
Yeah, for general and stable?
No. When you describe your categories, shifts with support.
Yeah, for this, yeah, in general, it's kind of, it gets such theoretic problems for identity functors. Should go in two large categories, but otherwise, you can make it small. Yeah, no, I just want to say it's about motifs. Up to now, all motifs which we see are coming from algebraic geometry. Maybe there's really no new things at all. But at least it's all things. I think that's the essence of the idea of motifs. It's non-commutative rod, not a commutative one. Yeah. Now I'll start to. What is really new in non-commutative rod? Except this absence of topology, which is negative news. Again, a kind of basic, remarkable effect which is going on is was discovered again in early 90s. By Bondal and Kapranov, semi-orthogonal decompositions. Now, so it will be maybe part 3 and the C phenomena. For saturated spaces. So we have, if you have a category of saturated spaces, that is perfect objects, and then it can contain as a full subcategories perfect object of, on another saturated space. What can have a part of the category which again is the same nature, and then turns it out it has both left and right orthogonals of the same nature. And they're naturally and they're equivalent. And one can maybe these orthogonals also can decompose. And in principle, what can happen is that this perfect category contains a bunch of subcategories. A kind of perfect X1, perfect Xm. And it's generated by these categories. And there is no homes, let's say, going from right to the left. So the all homes go on the direction. So any object you can canonically decompose. And for example, if you consider perfect complexes of Pn, and you get shifts or 0, 1, or n, have only homes in from left to right, but not from right to left. That's a typical example of symmetrical decomposition. So you see that Pn from this non-commutative point is built from n plus 1 point. So it's completely defies the usual definition. So it's kind of like point. We build another point on top of it. Yeah, so it's, this is a picture of Pn in this rod, which is very bizarre. And what is really more bizarre on this semi-orthogonal decomposition is this action of a braid group. You replace left by right, and it turns out satisfy braid relation, which is again something which from which we don't have a priori intuition and commutative rod. Yeah, that's one interesting story. In another, we have huge symmetries. Yeah, for example, consider elliptic curve E raised to some big power n, and then consider automorphism of this category. And up to shifts, it contains the group SP to NZ. It's kind of generalization of Fourier Mockai transform. Why is this group? And actually, if you add shift, you get the central extension of SP to NZ. You see that this is group actually a fundamental group of moduli space of principally polarized abelian varieties. Usual topological fundamental group in complex sense.
Yeah, and again, something which is ends up mirror symmetry in the sense it's kind of huge generalization, is it says that Artmore Fusion group of graph category of Calabi-Yau varieties is fundamental group of modular space of some other Calabi-Yau varieties. And here that's the fundamental group in plane topological space start to play a kind of central role in drag geometry, which it didn't play before because it was profound completion. But here's honest topological group. Yeah, so it's one kind of miracle. Another thing is the following: one can have Calabi-Yau varieties of fractional dimension, which is again, it's something pretty bizarre. For example, consider algebra, not being considered non computed spectrum of the algebra, which is upper triangular matrices, n by n upper triangular matrices. Or the same as past algebra or Dinkin Weaver AM. Then one can calculate what is the third functor. It's is a calculation. And then the third functor raised to power n minus n plus 1 is equal to shift by n minus 1. So it behaves like Calabi-Yau dimension equal to n minus 1 over n plus 1. Fractional number. Again, it works again like a charm. If you had such different fields n, you take tensor product of such guy to get dimension integer. Then there are plenty of examples. Then you get actual Calabi-Yau varieties. You divide by cyclic group, and you get the same triangulated category. So, that's one, I think. And last thing, it's some there's really plenty of stuff, but. One can make a kind of some new look on algebraic geometry from the following perspective. If S over K is singular string of finite type, so given by equation with very bad singularities, then one, there exists a smooth non-commutative space X such as perfect. It will be affine, yeah, and the perfect complexes on this X will be the same as coherent shifts on S, or boundary derived category of coherent shifts on X. Now, this is a result by Valery Lutz, and in fact, it's something like finite type, so one can develop some intuition related to singular space as kind of smooth space and some closed subset. So that's there's plenty of bizarre things. Let's go on. And now I go to my last part of the talk. It's very brief. Our perspective from mirror symmetry, which explains some of such miracles, not all of them, but. Story. Poincaré categories and mirror symmetry. There are kind of new non-commutative space built from kind of another source of data, which kind of generalization of topology example. Suppose I have kind of C infinity symplectic manifold, and it has a closed subset, which is Lagrangian, but should have pretty arbitrary singularities. Thus, maybe say it's sub-analytic singularity, so I find too many pieces at each point. There's really very little constraint on this. Then this thing can construct, it give you some wrapped, what's called wrapped Foucault category,
And this category is defined over integers. It's hypothetically defined. I think it's it's defined over integers. And here's some geometric intuitions. Actually, it's actually sheaf in usual topology of categories, and we take kind of global sections. So this natural defined sheaf on any singular Lagrange manifolds, locally defined. Over K, yeah, one can make tensor product over K and then
these are not just complexes of abelian groups.
Yeah, just abelian groups, yeah. Yeah. And on smooth spot, this stock is category associated to a point. It's complexes of vector space or abelian groups, so that's nothing. And for example, if considering infinite line R, because it's kind of constant shift of category, you get a point. This Fourier category just complexes. But if you get singularity, for example, if it's fork with three edges, you get category of representation of quiver A2, just morphism. And what really says is that you have three object here, three complexes, they form exact triangle. That's sufficient in dimension one. In high dimension, it's more complicated. And then we can draw some table of pictures. What is going on? For example, if you consider a circle sitting in its neighborhood of Cartesian bundle. This category depends only on neighborhood of germ of Lagrange manifold. You don't need the whole Lagrange, so cool symplectic manifold. And I'll draw examples in two-dimensional symplectic manifolds in surface and take a curve. And we draw these things which we discussed, the circle. It was example A1 minus 0. It was my first example of exotic equivalence. But now, if you consider circle plus infinite ray, you just get a fine line. How one can... But now, if you take circle and two infinite rays, you get projective line. And here you see some, again, kind of reminds you of usual break geometry. Projective line is glued from two affine lines, its intersection is affine line minus zero. And you see that this guy is union of two such objects, its intersection is a circle. And using this scheme, one can do even schemes with importance and stacks. Yeah, for example, if one make universal cover of this guy, one get infinite comp. Make universal car. And this corresponds to the Artin stack, affine line divided by JM. Yeah, so it's a pretty beautiful game. Stratified manifold with some kind of nice weakness stratification, one can take conormal bundle and get this Lagrangian manifold in Cartesian space. Then you get this special shifts with constructible shift with some supported kind of generalization, maybe to micro local supports and things like this. And here we get nice locality. So we get locality picture like an algebraic geometry. But actual Foucault categories, it's not this guy, it's maybe some deformation of the things. Now, if M is convex to infinity, like imagine like affine, smooth affine variety of Stein domain with some Keter metric, then it gives certain deformation of this Foucault category. Over non-Archimedean field. Maybe I just put my base with k, but add some variable, which now raise not to integer, but to real powers. And what is real powers? Yeah, essentially it's got corrected by some holomorphic disks for some common complex structure with boundary on L. And you take t to the positive number, which is integral of the disk. Yeah, so it's not yet finished story how these categories deform, but expected that this deformation is kind of infinity sense. It's absolutely canonical, doesn't depend on choice of complex structure and things like this. Yeah, so get. And here we lose locality because these disks will be not really local, with boundary with loops, really lose locality. So it's in the limit only we have locality. And this will be Foucault category. If we make sufficiently large Lagrange manifold, it will be Foucault category. And that's kind of way to look on various triangulated categories from which you see, for example, symmetries, like simple ectomorphism groups will be excellent Foucault category, and let's explain these huge symmetry groups. But this, a new development is the possibility to add, to extend Foucault categories by adding coefficients. What one can imagine, M is again stratified. By our say by complex strata or kind of symplectic strata, even dimensional strata. Like you imagine, Keller manifold is have holomorphic stratification by holomorphic subsets, and then we can speak about some kind of perilous shifts or what Misha Kapranov and Vadik Shakti called Schroeder's of triangulated categories on this set. So it will be locally constant shift long stratification. It's not really a shift, first of all. It will be some more complicated gadget, but at least on each smooth stratum you get local system and some relations, some kind of spherical functors. It's a pretty complicated story. And in particular, one can think about example when manifold is a disk, strata is several points, and you singular Lagrangian, you draw a picture like this. But then one can change this singular Lagrangian applying braid group. It will not change the category. It explains the story, at least partially, the story about braid group action on semi-orthogonal decomposition. So this natural geometric explanation of such guy, and I think this is the future of Foucault category business, to have add shifts, like in usual motifs, we want to have not just motifs, but shifts and so on. It's that's the story. And there's also a project which goes on. It's with
a big part of the puzzle that you didn't mention, it's Bridgen stability structures.
It's somehow a choice of T-structure and some stability in the sense of Mumford or the category. So you can describe objects in some decomposed to stable paths, like stable vector bundles, stable coherent shifts in vector geometry. And it's a very beautiful, nice picture in general, which is very hard to construct. And conjecturally, if you have stability structure on this sheaf of categories, it's very simple. That somehow should be functional for K group to complex numbers or maybe one dimensional space, but with values in canonical bundle, then on this new category will be again stability structure. So it will be kind of tame this equation to construct stability structures. And there are plenty of speculations. For example, this is like Keller plus and should be like something like Keller metric if my field is complex numbers or non-Archimedean field. One can try to see this, some analysis here, boson, special Lagrangians, and so on. One can see this really kind of like Keller metric on this non-primitive space, but it's a bit too early to speak about this story. Thank you.
Enhanced DG category of
yes,
K,
yes.
Right? I'm just saying
yeah.
This is equivalent to saying these are HK module spectra.
Yeah, one can go to module spectra, yeah.
So
yeah.
The natural generality which one could consider this is that I fix some infinity ring and consider.
No, infinity symmetric monodule category with collimates, and things should be enriched on this guy here. Yeah. As a base should be kind of like commutative.
What I'm trying to ask is
yeah.
Is there a restriction to a ground field necessary?
No. Just
if I allowed myself an arbitrary E infinity ring as my ground,
yeah, it's okay. Yeah, it's just to make it things concrete and yeah.
So it's okay means
yeah, the whole thing's work. Sure, yeah, just
That's it. Maybe more about this property
that is related. It's really
property.
It's property then in which yeah, it's. No. One can say the definition like this: this is triangulated category. It's category enriched by spaces like infinity one category. Get some space of maps which has homotopy limits and collimates and finite homotopy limits and finite homotopy collimates, and they commute with each other. Yeah. So there are plenty of ways to say. So natural morphism from limit of collimate to collimate of limit is I equivalence. Yeah.
Is there a role for tensor Karamkov in these non-commutative space?
Yeah, of course. No, the tensor product I used to define smoothness half diagonal. Yeah. There is some structure of tensor product, definitely.
I find it surprising that you get rid of the tensor product on the category of complex over
No.
But of course, that the
yes.
The rule of the game.
Again, on the definition of non-commutative space.
Yeah.
The morphism you have between your DG categories, you require the adjoint to be omega accessible, right?
Given by tensor
product. On to the requirement that it commits to finite limits and finite limits, which is.
No, infinite. No, I want infinite limits. Want this.
Finite automatics, omega continuity.
Sir?
Why do you ask omega continuity?
Because it's more or less says that it's for algebras, it's functions given by tensor product. Yeah, that's it.
More questions? Okay, well, let's thank the speaker.